mass and anatomical and behavioral differences you see between them. And they propose that changes in gene regulation may frequently underlie phenotypic evolution. And so this, in recent years, has led to a lot of debate on the relative contributions of protein versus regulatory changes in phenotypic evolution. And this is sometimes called, the argument for the predominance of regulatory evolution is sometimes called the cis-regulatory hypothesis. And the idea is that cis-regulatory changes, which are cis-regulatory regions, are stretches of non-coding DNA that bind things like transacting factors, are capable of being less pleiotropic than changes in the genes themselves. So in this example, we have two cis-regulatory regions associated with a gene, and changes in the kidney are not going to affect mRNA abundance in the liver, whereas a change in the protein would potentially change that in every tissue. So there are now really good examples of this. For example, lactose tolerance in humans, adaptive variation in coat color in deer mice. But a lot of these examples don't come from unbiased surveys, and few of these are examples of complex traits. And so today I'll be talking to you about identifying evidence for adaptive regulatory variation of using house mice collected along the latitudinal line in North America. So house mice are recent additions to North America. They arrived with humans less than 400 years ago to the East Coast. And despite that, they show evidence of clinal adaptation. So mice from the north of the latitude are larger in terms of body mass and body size. And this variation is clinal. And it's consistent with Bergman's rule, which is a classical observation that mice that in colder climates or at higher latitudes will frequently be larger to reduce heat loss. And so this difference actually persists in the lab. When you take these mice into the lab and breed them, those mice from the northern populations are still larger. And this comes also with a suite of metabolic differences that have been assessed in the lab as well. There's differences in activity levels as well as blood chemistry like triglyceride levels, adiponectin levels, leptin levels, and glucose levels. So today I'm going to talk to you about the role of regulatory variation in this clinal adaptation. So to do this, we've looked at the overlap between three different signals. And so we're looking at this in a clinal framework. And so clines can be good evidence of local adaptation when they're not confounded by demography. And so, for example, if we have a situation where we see an allele frequency cline that overlaps with loci that are associated with variation in expression, or EQTLs, and the genes associated with those EQTLs are also expressed clinally, that would be good evidence for adaptive regulatory variation. And so those are the cases we're going to look for. So I'm going to go through each of those things in turn, but first a little bit about the sampling. So this sampling was done by Megan Pfeiffer-Rixey. She collected mice from the East Coast of North America, 50 individuals from 5 populations. Those black dots represent the locations of those individuals. Livers were collected in RNA later, and that's what was sequenced for expression data. Liver was chosen because it's obviously a very metabolically active tissue. And we also have exome capture at 15x coverage to look at sequence variation. And so first, looking at allele frequency clines. So this was, again, Megan Pfeiffer-Rixey who did this, who's at Monmouth. She used the program latent factor mixed models to correlate allele frequencies with latitude while controlling for population structure. And so in that case, you're looking for a situation like this, where you have a gradual change in allele frequencies across this transect. And I should mention now that this pattern could also be the effect of something like isolation by distance, but on the East Coast of North America, there is actually no isolation by distance, so that's not going to confound clinal patterns of variation. All right, and so here are the results of this analysis. And so this is the Manhattan plot where we have the z-score output from LFMM versus the position. And for the purposes of this talk and identifying overlap, I'll be looking at outliers with z-scores greater than 2 corresponding to the tails of the distribution. And most of these sites actually do fall in non-coding regions. All right, so moving on to identifying EQTLs. So we're specifically going to be looking for cis-EQTLs today, and the reason for that is that cis-EQTLs are easier to detect in smaller sample size, and this has been successfully done in wild individuals, which is what we're using. And so if you're not familiar with sensory detail mapping, this is very similar to an association study. You look at a variant and try to associate it with the phenotype, which is expression in this case. And so here we have a situation where a G is conferring lower expression, whereas C is conferring higher expression. And so we did this by testing variants within 200 kb of a gene for associations with expression using a linear mixed model approach that accounted for population structure implemented in the program demo. All right, and so here are the results of that. So we identified 850 genes with evidence of CCQTL. Everything above that line is significant after a Bonferroni correction of 5%. And reflecting the probe set, so again, these variants are based on exome data. Most of these are falling in gene bodies or in introns. And so I should mention that this is about 5% of the 6% of the genes that we were surveyed had CCQTL. All right, and so finally, looking at clinal gene expression patterns. So here we simply looked for associations between latitude and gene expression level. And this is, again, another Manhattan plot where you're looking at the chromosome position versus the correlation with latitude on this side. And this may be a little hard to see, but there are a bunch of green dots here. And those are cases where we have significant clinal gene expression, and those genes also have CCQTL. And so there are 132 of those dots. And in 17 cases, the CCQTL associated with those also overlap with an outlier in a clinal scan. So just to say that one more time, we have 17 cases where a gene CCQTL overlaps with a clinal outlier. So when I say overlaps, it's an LD with a clinal outlier in lineage disequilibrium, and the expression of that gene is also clinal. And reassuringly, we also find that when those CCQTL co-localize with a clinal outlier, they're more likely to have expression significantly correlated. All right, so we've now identified 17 genes at this intersection that have very good evidence of an adaptive regulatory variant segregating on the east coast of North America. We can now ask whether any of those genes we've identified also have mutant phenotypes in lab mice that are associated with the phenotypes that I talked to you about before. So remember I mentioned that there are metabolic differences in populations on the east coast. And we can also look at whether those have associations with phenotypic variation in the wild mice that we're actually surveying. And specifically, I'll be talking about body mass because that's the phenotype we have. So like I said, body mass is varying finally in this case, and so we can look at whether any of these variants are associated with body mass. And so starting with looking at whether mutant phenotypes in lab mice are associated with any of these genes, we find that five of the genes that, with that three overlap actually have phenotypes associated with those differences. So we have genes with differences that are associated with differences in glucose levels, triglyceride levels, adiponectin levels, leptin levels, body mass, and activity level. And so you'll notice that there are two cases where those genes have mutant phenotypes associated with body mass. And so then when we looked at whether any of these CCQTL had associations with body mass, interestingly, we found those two genes were actually the ones that did. And so this is ADAM17 and BCAT2. ADAM17 and BCAT2 both have expression that is correlated with body mass in these mice. And ADAM17 and BCAT2 CCQTL genotype is associated with differences in body weight in the wild mice. And so I'll just take you through now slowly the case for ADAM17. So just really quickly, like I said, ADAM17 mutant phenotypes for it in lab mice is associated with differences in body weight. It's something that sits at the top of a bunch of signaling cascades and has been associated with metabolic disorders in humans. And it varies clinally its expression across the East Coast. As you can see, it's got a significant CCQTL. And that CCQTL is varying along the cline and is region is an LD with a bunch of clinal outliers. So in parentheses there is the alpha mem score, and many of those are above 2, which is our outlier threshold. And so then when we look at this, this gene's expressions associated with body mass, we controlled for latitude because, again, body mass and latitude are covariant. So when you control for latitude, ADAM17 expression is associated with body mass, very significantly associated with body mass. And we also see this association in individual populations as well. So here's individuals just from the New Hampshire and Vermont population, and so obviously that's not very many individuals, but you can see that there's a significant association there. Ooh. And then finally, the ADAM-cis-CQTL trends with body mass when latitude is controlled for. And actually this cis-CQTL, when you control for body mass, accounts for 70% of the variation in body mass. All right, so we found 17 genes total that show evidence of adaptive regulatory variation on the East Coast of North America. We found 3 genes that also have mutant phenotypes associated with phenotypes we see in these mice, and then 2 which have been directly associated with body mass. All right, so just in summary, we've identified regulatory variation in natural populations of mice, evidence for adaptive cis regulatory variation along latitudinal line, and candidates associated with adaptive phenotypic variation in body mass. Thank you. Metabolism. So it's associated with mitochondria.